Hello everybody, I hope you enjoyed the workshop with Boris Kozlov, the bassist from the Mingus Big Band. It was open to all for one week and now it's available exclusively to members of the website. However, I wanted to share with you some of the key takeaways I took from his workshop. First, one thing that I really make mine is the statement that improvising is composing in real time. And according to Boris, this is actually a quote attributed to Charles Mingus. I've heard that before, and this is definitely something that I make mine. Improvisation is composition in real time, in the moment. All right, so that's a big thing I want to take. Improvisation is composing in real time. All right, so that means when you improvise, you have to think as a composer. And this is really what I, how I teach when I have private students. I teach improvisation, but I really teach composition, all right? Because that means that to improvise, you have to understand and master what I like to call the shaping forces of music. And this is a great term that I didn't invent. I stole it from this great book that I highly recommend, called The Shaping Forces of Music by Ernst Tuck. It's divided in four chapters, the four shaping forces of music, which are harmony, melody, counterpoint, and form. All right, and those four forces are really important, both for composer and us improvisers. Another thing he said that I really liked, he said, no matter how simple the bass line is, it is a melody, and therefore it will use the same concept for melodic development. So a couple of things about that. First, that means that you can create something good out of simple material, all right? So, in other words, good is not necessarily equal to complex, complicated, hard, all right? It can be, you can create something good, interesting, with complex ideas, but you can certainly create something good with simple ideas, simple material. So that's good for a bass line, but that's good for any instrument playing a melody. He said the bass line is a melody, and when we improvise, we have to create a melody, and a melody to create a good melody, again, we have to think as a composer. A good melody must have a good beginning, some kind of development, and very importantly, a resolution. Good beginning, development, and resolution. Now, the cement, what connects all of this, it's going to be your rhythm. All right? With something simple, and then something very simple, If you have strong rhythm, this is going to work, and you can create something interesting with simple material if you have good rhythm. And again, I'm not talking about, you know, something, some complex rhythm. I'm talking about time, being able to play some simple rhythmic ideas, but in time with a strong rhythmic feel. I'm not talking about polyrhythms, 7-4, 15/7. No, I'm talking about 4-4. All right. Again, a melody must have a good beginning, strong beginning. The most important, to tell you the truth, the most important is a strong beginning and a strong resolution. If you have a good beginning, a strong beginning, you can develop. If you have a good resolution, then your phrase makes sense. If you don't have a good resolution that makes musical sense, then that's when it sounds weird, all right? Because it's like when you're talking. If you start a phrase and that's how you stop, then it sounds weird. The same thing in music. When I have students that play phrases that sound weird, it's because musically they don't end their phrase with musical sense. So how do you do that? Well, it's going to have a lot to do with the choice of note that you end your phrase with. It's going to have a lot to do with your rhythm. If you're rhythmically do not make sense, whatever note you're playing, it's not gonna sound good, all right? And also where you end your phrase. And a good rule of thumb, it's not, you know, I'm not saying that you always have to do that, but the vast majority of the time, musical phrases are going to be inside the frame of four bars. So maybe I'm just going to do like this. Inside four bars. And look at the songs, the standards, or even pop songs, classical pieces. The vast majority of the phrases are constructed inside a frame of four bars. I'm not saying that sometimes it's less, sometimes it's more, but usually it's inside four bars. So let's see. If we take a 2-5-1, and we're going to use a very simple material, and we're going to use the basic triad of the chord, all right? No scales, not even the scales, no upper structure, no pentatonics, no bebop scales, nothing. Basic triads. However, I'm going to create a melody, and we're going to be with a strong beginning, development, and a resolution. And it's going to be inside a cycle, a form of the frame, sorry, of four bars, and all is going to be connected, everything's going to be connected with the rhythm. So, simple 2-5-1, and I'm going to use only the triads, but I'm going to have four bar phrases and brief. Resolution means also the silence, all right? Brief between your phrases. One, a two, a one, two, three, four. Material, just basic triads, but the rhythm is there, and I create melodies inside a 4-bar frame with a beginning, development, resolution. I breathe between my phrases and everything is connected through a strong rhythm. He said it. He said we are all rhythmic partners. So that's another key takeaway. We are all rhythm partners. Of course, bass and drums, they really have to lock in. You know, that's even more important. But if you have a good rhythm section, but you as a soloist, you're completely, you know, playing out of time, this is not going to sound good, and this is not going to be fun for the bass and the bassist and the drummer, and they're just not going to want to play with you again. Alright? So, we are all rhythm partners, we are all responsible of rhythm, of the rhythm and of the time. Of course, if we have to give a hierarchy, drummer and both with the bass player, they really, that's, you know, really their kingdom, but the soloists have their partners for that as well. We saw during the rock shop that we can use the a bass line and develop it into a real like bebop phrase. So let's take an example. We can see my high-tech video production. Okay, let's see. I remember he had a bass line that were just, he was talking about diatonic bass line. So over a B flat 7 and just going down diatonically the scale and resolving on the one, E flat major 7. Alright, when we have two bars of B flat 7, we can totally, as improvisers, think the 2-5, so F minor 7, B flat 7. And one idea, alright, first, it's almost like filling in the blanks. I'm going to do like this. I'm going to copy the original phrase. So that you really can see that the phrase is there, the bass line is there. And all I'm going to do is add notes between. All right, so the melody is, that's actually the bass line. 1, 2, 3, 4. Alright, now we take that bass line and make it the melody. Alright, first you can improvise rhythmically. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, now I developed it melodically like this. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, and actually I think I wrote this. Alright, so it's almost exactly the same. I could actually make it exactly the same by playing a B flat here. That doesn't really matter, it's really the same, the exact same shape, right? The melodic shape. And the resolution. Alright? So, first example. see how I just took that bass line and added, I added those notes. Now the bass line is exactly the same. On the downbeat, it's exactly the same note. Now this is cool. This is totally a phrase that you can hear, you could play. The only critique you may have is that it's, again, the melodic shape is exactly the same. Alright, so let's see if we can come up with something else. And of course the answer is yes. Let's see, maybe... First, I like that. Alright, so now I'm having a little more development, but I'm still having the notes F, E flat, D. So yes, E flat is displaced. Of course, you know, at some point, if you develop, you're going to change the melody. So the E flat is displayed because we have this arpeggio inserted here. Here we're going to have a little, also I'm trying to think rhythmically. You see how here is just eighth notes. Do do da u 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 da u. Now I'm going to add more rhythmic idea. Alright. Something like this. So here I'm going to keep our original idea, which was that, and maybe change a little bit the melody at the end. So alright, but you see how the target notes are the same, and that some of them are a little displaced, but the global direction of the melody is the same. F, E flat, D, C, B flat, A flat, G, F, and B flat. With the chords, 1, 2, 3, 4. Alright, so that was an interesting point from the workshop as well, how you can take ideas, again, simple idea, right? It's just the scale going down and develop that melody because you are thinking as a composer. Another idea he mentioned that I like, he said to use different melodic development ideas to make your melody interesting, which is kind of what we did here. Alright, this was the first development, and then, you know, I changed, I used arpeggios and more rhythmic activity. Because if you use only, I mean, this is cool, but, you know, there's some kind of monotony due to the fact that first the rhythm is all the same, do da u 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 da u, so no rhythmic variety, and the melodic shape is the same here and there. So, you know, try to incorporate different ideas. I mean, there's so many of them, you know, like basic chord tones, upper structure triads, scales, pentatonics, hexatonics, you know, on and on. So just like mix different ideas like this to create more interest and more variety in your lines. One thing we discussed also that was really interesting, and we see that more in detail in the workshop, is that understanding, I'm running out of room here, but understanding a concept is one thing, understanding a concept is one thing, but implementing it in your playing is another thing, alright? So, meaning, implementing, but once you understand a concept, like for instance, improvising, the concept of improvising with basic triad in a frame of four bars with beginning, development, and a resolution, everybody understands that. The risk is that you're like, okay, I understand, that's fine. Give me something else. In very often, I'm gonna ask, okay, well, it's show me, do it, you know? And often, it's not going to be convincing. And so that's because you have to put in the time to work to implement what you have understood, all right? Again, don't make the mistake of, okay, I understand, so give me more, I want to learn more. We have to think as a composer. We are composing, but in real time, which is really the key and the challenge. Because when you're composing, and well, you know, you have time to think, sing your melody and think about the harmony and correct what needs to be corrected. When you're improvising, you don't have that luxury. If you make a mistake, either you find a way to turn this mistake into not a mistake, which is what what we do very often, or you have to live with your mistake and say, okay, well, this one I really screwed up, and this is it. You cannot come back in the past. All right, so implement what you have learned. So same thing, the idea of using triads sounds easy, but to implement that in your playing is not always the case. Also, obviously, in all 12 keys. All right, so those were some of the takeaways from the workshop. Again, the members of the website can go back to the video and watch it again. There's a lot of great ideas, and we're going to work on those ideas in the coming weeks.